our world religion class or from that documentary that we watch on TV, the story of a rich man, Siddhartha Gautama, who abandoned all his wealth and all his fulfillment.
Sorry. In pursuit of something greater, of understanding, of knowledge, and of enlightenment. And if you know anything about the story of Siddhartha, you know that he went to the woods and he pursued a life of asceticism, a life in which he abstains from all sort of nourishment, from food, from any sort of drink, and put himself under tremendous emotional and physical torment. But then after 7 years of doing that, he realized he was no closer to enlightenment than when he was filled with richness and with fulfillment. One day, in this rot, completely destroyed, with no money left in his pocket, and with his mind and body tormented, Siddhartha decided that he would walk into the woods and he would commit suicide. But then that did not happen. He walked in and he saw a river, and he saw his reflection in the mirror, in the river, the coursing river and the breezes of the wind. And he realized at that moment that he wanted to become one with the world around him. That he wanted to unite himself with the forces of nature. And at that moment, Siddhartha Gautama became the Buddha. So yes, everyone knew about the story about Siddhartha, so I'm not going to explain any further. And my goal here in this talk is not to give you a 101 introduction to Buddhism, but rather it is to share my own story, to share my own personal perspective on what I feel Buddhism is. So I'll start by talking to you about Buddhism in my childhood. So I come from a family where we're considered like the holiday Buddhist or the part-time Buddhist. We would engage ourselves in Buddhist holidays. We would practice Buddhist traditions like the Lunar New Year or the Savat. And we would even go as far as going to the temple once in a while and put our hands together and pretend that we are actually knowing what we're praying about. And that was the extent of my exposure to Buddhism. When I was a little kid, I would be really excited whenever it's time for the new year. We would go to the temple because they always provide the best snacks there for free. And yes, I've been as interested in eating as I am now when I was a little kid. So yeah, that was basically my exposure to Buddhism when I was a kid. I was a part-time Buddhist, and I was totally fine with that. I had other concerns. I wanted to play with toy cars. I wanted to talk with my friends, to hang out, and I didn't care about my background, or I didn't care about the times that we go to the temple. I would just run around the temple, and I would just look at the gigantic statues and stare right at me, and I would even laugh at them, because I had no idea what they meant, and they didn't look human to me. So only a couple of years back, I was talking to one of my best friends from Vietnam. By this point, I'm already in the US, and this friend of mine, she was telling me about how Buddhism had completely changed her life and how it had provided her with a completely refreshing perspective on where she is in life. And with so much hesitation, I decided that I would follow her and I would see what this thing was all about and follow my past legacy. Maybe even see if I could even discover something from my childhood that I didn't know about. So then I started going back to the temples that I went to when I was a kid. I started listening to the lectures by the Dalai Lama. I started researching about Buddhism. I learned about the Eightfold Path, the Four Noble Truths, you know, all the classic stuff about Buddhism. And to be honest, at that time, I really didn't understand most of the stuff I was reading. Everything was so new to me. Everything was so strange. Whenever I exposed myself to this newfound knowledge of Buddhism, I always felt like my mind had opened up just a little bit, even though I had no idea what I was reading about. And then when I was going back to the temples, I would read the plaques and see what they say. And then I would actually look up what the different figures in the temple. So if you don't know, the bodhisattvas in the Buddhist religion are basically like the gods of the Buddhist religion, or the patron saints. And they have statues of the bodhisattvas everywhere in the temples. So I would look up what they actually meant and what those bodhisattvas do. And I felt like it didn't make any like clear changes in my schedule. Like I started meditating, I started becoming a vegetarian, But that part was not as hard to me as accepting a lot of the stuff that Buddhism was talking about, that I truly didn't really understand. But there was this one part about Buddhism that just really intrigued me, and that is a figure that the Buddhists call the Bodhisattva of Compassion, or otherwise known in my language as the Gwanangodat, or in the language, or in India is known as Avalokiteshvara. So what the Bodhisattva of Compassion did was, in the Vietnamese Buddhist culture, she was portrayed as this woman that is dressed beautifully, that is sitting on a leaf of lotus, completely cognizant of everything around her, with her eyes closed, with a thousand arms stretched in 10 different directions. And that was the figure that intrigued me the most, because, yeah, the Bodhisattva of Compassion. I've always known that Buddhism was a religion about love and compassion and peace, and she just embodied all of that. And I just thought her statue was so cool, with all the 10 arms just stretching everywhere. And there are statues of her everywhere in Vietnam. And one of the saying that this Bodhisattva was known the most for is Om Mani Padme Hum. And this saying translated to English as the jewel is in the lotus. By this point, I had no idea what that meant, the jewel is in the lotus. But I just thought the imagery was really interesting. And whenever I went into a vegetarian restaurant, they would play the chant over and over again. So I just kind of stuck in my head. So like any good coming of age story, my personal story had a climax, or had a point in which I just realized that everything in my life had changed. And that point for me happened earlier this year in May, when I had lost my cousin. My cousin had passed away at the age of 18 due to cancer, and he was in Arizona at the time. And after such a hard-fought battle against cancer for over 6 months, his parents was with him, and it was just completely devastating. He was 18 years old. No one had imagined that that would happen to him. No one had imagined that he would just pass away and just have a whole future of so much greatness ahead of him. He had so much talent. He had so much potential. And when I heard the news, I was at CFS, and I was just in a complete state of devastation. I had no idea what to do with my life. I had no idea how I would be able to go on and keep going to school and keep talking to my friends and keep finishing the school year. Because the news just struck me like a blow and hit me down on the ground. I talked to many people, a couple of people in the CLS community, and they really lifted me up. And I'm so thankful for them. But still, in my heart, there was such a vacancy. I felt so empty. I felt as if there was a black hole in my heart, and I was just sinking inwardly into it, and I had nothing to do about it. And I couldn't even grieve. I couldn't even shed a tear. It was just absolutely devastating to me. And then after this, the school year ended, I came back to Vietnam. And the same feeling stuck with me. We had a funeral service in the Vietnamese culture. And the funeral service was Buddhist, so they said. It was drawn out. It was just completely traumatic of an experience for all parties involved. But one thing that stuck with me through that service was the fact that they kept saying, Om Mani Padme Hum, Om Mani Padme Hum, over and over again. That's the chant that was repeated the most. And at this point, I just felt a complete resentment for the Buddha statue that I had in my room. The Buddha, why didn't you help me? Why didn't you help bring my cousin back to life? Why didn't you help him so that he could be able to continue living a wonderful, a prosperous life that he had ahead of him? I had resentment for just everything around me, and I had so much hatred inside of me and so much anger. But the Om Mani Padme Hum, as much as I wanted to get out of my head, was still stuck in my head. And I had this image of just the lotus flower was shriveling and drying, and the jewel inside is turning into complete ashes. And this image is stuck in my head. But then one day while I was just wandering around, I came to a temple nearby to my house. And this temple had the word Om Mani Padme Hum written on it. But then underneath, there was also this story. And the story was called The Parable of the Mustard Seed. So you come from a Christian tradition. You know that Christianity has the parable of mustard seed. But Buddhism also has a story that happens to have the same name, but it's completely different. So I'm going to tell you the story. In the times of the Buddha, there was this woman whose name was Kisa Gautama. She has to labor for a very rich family, and she was very happy when she gave birth to her firstborn son. However, only a couple months later, her son passed away, and this woman, so distraught and so devastated, brought her son's body to every single doctors, to every single houses that she could find in the village to see if anyone could resurrect her son. But to her dismay, no one could. Everyone laughed at her and said, "Your son is already dead." But then one day, she came upon the Buddha's doorstep, and the Buddha told her that she had come to every single house in the village and asked for a mustard seed from any of the house without any one in which none of the people in the house had died, she would be able to bring her son back to life. So this woman became so happy when she heard that news, and she started going around the village asking each house to see if they have if they have never had any member of their family dead before, and to see if they could give her a mustard seed. But the more she goes, the more house she visits, the more she realized that every family had suffered from the same loss as she did. Every family had suffered from the same heartbreak where they had lost a member of their family. And with each house, she became less lonely. And then she decided that it was finally time to accept that her son had passed away. And this story at that time just touched me so deeply. The story of this woman who was so defenseless, who was in the same exact position as I was, so lonely, so empty, couldn't even express my emotions. And for the first time, I felt that there was this load that was just lifted off of my shoulder because someone had gone through the same exact thing that I had gone through, even though I know that it might even be a fictional story. And then when I came back home, I started meditating for the first time in a really long time. And then I started thinking about this concept that my friend and I had talked about way earlier, the concept of impermanence. So if you know anything about the Buddhist tradition, you know that impermanence is a very big part of the Buddhist tradition, because in Buddhism, it says that everything around you and everything within you is impermanent, and the only thing that is permanent is death. Even though this might be a very morbid thing to think about, it's also very uplifting to think that everything around you it is very fleeting, and your existence itself is also very fleeting. So it's a very good way to think about death and dying, because it's something that's inevitable. I started reading stuff about Tibetan Buddhism and how they deal with death, and they said that it was okay to grieve. Grieving is a very normal part of the human experience. But just know that even though you have perished, even though your body has turned into ashes, what is inside you, your soul, is always permanent. And your soul is the culmination of your legacy, is the culmination of all the emotions you've experienced in your life, is the culmination of all the experiences that you've experienced. And if you have a pure soul, if you can continue to acquire so much emotion and you have a really great legacy, then your soul will just be everlasting. And the only thing that will perish is your flesh or is your body. And I just felt this thought was so incredibly uplifting. And then I started thinking about it. The jewel is in the lotus. The jewel is our soul. And even though the lotus leaf might one day perish, it might die, it might wrinkle, it might shrivel, the jewel inside of it will always stay permanent. It will always be there, ever shining. And then after that meditation session, I had an image of my cousin just sitting on a lotus leaf, smiling at me with his brilliant smile and waving at me. And then at that time, I just felt completely liberated. It was the first time in so long that I was able to put myself to actually cry. And it's kind of a reverse effect, because even though Buddhism talks to you about how it is okay for you, death is inevitable, and death is a permanent thing. It's also okay for you to cry, okay for you to show emotions to the dead. And I did that day. And that day, I just realized that my approach to Buddhism had been so wrong for the time before that. And the experience completely changed my life. So yeah, like Siddhartha Gautama, I'm on a journey. And that journey is maybe not even towards enlightenment, but that journey is towards understanding myself more and towards understanding everything around me more. And perhaps I'll never be able to reach enlightenment, or perhaps one day I'll just not continue that journey. But for now, I'm incredibly happy, I'm incredibly grateful that I am on this journey, and it has allowed me to cherish my life much more, and to love everything around me, and to love the fact that I am here. Maybe some moment afterwards, I might perish, any moment now, I might perish, but I know that my soul will still be in here. And I know that whenever I look up in the sky, I will see the Bodhisattva of compassion, sitting on that lotus leaf, smiling at me, her hand overreaching and caressing me on the shoulder. And I know that everything will be all right. So yeah, like I said in the beginning, the speech isn't meant to enlighten you. The speech isn't meant to be an introductory to Buddhism or 101 to Buddhism. But the speech is just how Buddhism has touched my life so deeply, and how it will continue to touch my life and the life of so many others. Om Mani Padme Hum.